Hi, I'm James Verdier, and welcome to the American Institute of Biological Sciences BioScience Talks, which is a forum for integrating the life sciences. On the second Wednesday of each month, and sometimes in between, we discuss the latest bioscience publications. And as a reminder, if you'd like to read more, point your browser to academic.oup.com/bioscience. On today's episode, we'll be discussing coronaviruses and other wildlife-borne illnesses, as well as disease dynamics and a number of other topics that I hope will help our listeners better understand and contextualize the current COVID-19 pandemic. My guests on the show are Dr. Mike Antolin, a professor of biology, and Dr. Dan Salkeld, who is a disease ecologist and also a previous guest on the show. Both are at Colorado State University. And before continuing, I should also mention that we urge all of our listeners to research and adhere to the appropriate public health guidance for their area. But for now, let's go to the interview. So first of all, I'd like to thank you both very much for joining me and being so generous of your time and insights during a very difficult period.
You're welcome.
Yeah, thanks for having us.
Okay, to get us started, I was hoping you could give us a little bit of an idea, just in a very general sense, of what we know about the origins of this current coronavirus that's resulted in a global pandemic. What do we know, and how much can we know at this point?
So what I've seen is a lot of phylogenetic analyses based on the sequences, the nucleotide sequences that have been pulled out of various collections that have been put online by various of my colleagues, not work that I've done myself, but that essentially shows that the variation in this virus essentially coalesces back to Wuhan, China in early December 2019, that it apparently really did come from this market in the center of that city. And all the genetic evidence shows that it spread from there and is starting to develop some genetic identity in different places where the epidemic is growing. But it's pretty clear that that's where the first alarm of cases by late December were known. And then even in early January, some of the sequencing was very indicative of that, and that's just held up.
No, I mean, I guess another take on that, though, is we don't know the source of the virus. So it's there have been different reports that emerged over time. So the first, I think, was suggesting it was from a snake. And then there were reports that it was from a pangolin. And then kind of often cited ancestor of this is somewhere in some kind of bat population. It's probably unlikely that we will be able to get a concrete identification of the source. So. But the biggest, I think, the general consensus is that it's supposed to be a zoonosis, so it's emerged from some kind of animal reservoir, but we don't know what it is.
And do we have any particular understanding of what would cause something like this to spill over into a human population at any given time?
Well, it's going to be opportunity. I mean, it's exposure of individuals to viral particles in some way, and in this case probably animals that were in that market. And I suspect these kinds of things, the exposures of course happen, I think, fairly regularly, and then the question is whether that particular pathogen is going to be adapted in a sense or pre-adapted to be able to infect and then to lead to person-to-person transmission, right? So it's a that's, to me, it's one of these almost inevitabilities of, given the numbers of people we have on the planet and how many exposures there are, that some or one of these will, spill over on a fairly regular basis. So it's really a question of which of those exposures lead to infection and then to onward transmission.
Okay, so it's more of a case in which we essentially have the conditions that allow it to happen, and then you get the wrong bug in the wrong place, and it's able to pass over into humans.
That's right, and some of the details of how that transmission will go will influence how far it will go, right? And so it's a and that's perhaps the one of the biggest unknown parts, both in the sense of how easily will this be transmitted, and when it does. The question of how much disease is it going to cause when it actually starts to, if it starts to continue to transmit, and then, what particular opportunities it has beyond that. you know, the original, the first SARS back in 2003, I think was a fairly similar virus, fairly similar kind of zoonotic origin, but at a very different disease progression and probably different transmission in the sense that asymptomatic or just barely pre-symptomatic individuals weren't transmitting. The people who were really sick were the ones who were infectious to other humans, and so therefore, once it was isolated into hospitals, it was able to be stopped. Right, and that's a that's one thing I would say is a big contrast between the 2003 SARS and this is a SARS again. It's not called that; it's called COVID, of course, but it's a similar kind of thing.
Right. Yeah. No, that's true. And I mean, amongst disease ecologists, we refer to it as spillover. And I think just breaking it down, you need an animal that carries this disease that is able then to jump into humans. So you have to have the ability for the pathogen to jump. You have to have the exposure from the normal host to a human. And then for it to actually take off, you have to have humans that are susceptible and allow it to amplify and transmit. And I think you're absolutely right. This is something that happens from time to time, and probably more often than we think, but it's the kind of rare occurrence that COVID-19 or the SARS from 2002 to 2004 or other things, that they occasionally take off and become these major infectious agents for human populations. And that's when we tend to worry about them. So it's happened frequently. We can think of things like HIV or hantavirus or Lyme West disease Nile. Or any of these kind of...
West Nile, Zika. Should we keep going?
It sounds like this is the kind of thing that, you know, obviously is repeated, but typically the degree is such that it's, you know, it appears as a blip on our radar, you know, in terms of the general public and the news, and then it fades away again because it doesn't quite have the characteristics that this one does.
Yeah, well, for instance, I mean, you know, as scary as Ebola was, right, that was a difficult pathogen to get onto airplanes and move around because, you know, people to transmit would actually be essentially right at the point of death, right? And it's a hemorrhagic disease, and so you had to be in close contact with that person at that time, right? And so that was different than this one. That's probably more transmissible, or is transmissible in a way that's maybe more similar to a cold virus, right? In the sense that individuals, just as they're becoming symptomatic, are, you know, aerosolizing this thing, and aren't prevented or, you know, debilitated in such a way that they can't move. And so this one moved because people were able to get on airplanes and go all around the world, right, while carrying this virus and being infectious, right? So that's the, you know, that's a really key difference, even for what happened with the previous SARS, right? Was that some individuals were able to do that, but they were, I would suspect, relatively not infectious until later on in the sort of disease etiology, right, of when they became, they only became infectious later on when they became debilitated, for instance, right? So, and that's a big, big difference.
And I think also it's one of these things, we never know what the course of the outbreak is going to look like. So, I mean, I teach a class in disease ecology, and each year I teach it, there is some emerging disease that is taking up media attention, and often these things do tend to fade, or they become accepted as the norm. So, Zika was one that it was massive for the year that it took that big outbreak and hit Brazil, traveled to the States, but subsequently it didn't seem to have taken off or maintained itself as much as people feared, and that allows it to disappear from the radar and then wait for the next candidate to be the emerging pandemic.
Right. And I wonder then, you know, is there a way that this can ever be seen coming? You know, we hear about them when they spill over, and they typically dominate our news cycles for a relatively brief time. This one obviously will for much longer than that. But is there a way that we can, you know what's hiding out in these reservoir species in advance of spillover? so that, you know, perhaps we could have a better response prepared than we have for this?
Yeah, that's a very good question. And essentially what you're talking about is disease surveillance. And can we actually keep track of what's potentially out there? That's a very difficult thing to, first of all, design well in the beginning, and second of all, maintain over long periods of time. I mean, imagine what you're actually trying to do is you're trying to take all of nature and somehow sample it and perhaps store samples in such a way that you're able then to determine what exists in those at that time or potentially would be into the future. You know, if you just think about, you know, SARS itself or these coronaviruses, was, you know, in 2003, it was actually considered fairly innovative that it was able to be identified as quickly as it was because of the change in molecular biological techniques and DNA sequencing and RNA sequencing that allowed identity of this virus as that quickly, right? And now, of course, we have the ability to detect them as well. But the thing is, you know, where would you expect to go looking for them, right? Is it bats? Is it pangolins? Is it snakes? Is it, you know, what is it? Is it rodents? And then, you know, just think of the issues associated with just storing samples. Let's say you go out and you send someone out on an expedition to collect things, and that needs to be stored someplace in such a way that would then be tested in such a way that would be predictive, right? And if you think about, you know, SARS from 2003 to this now, 17 years later, you know, would we have samples from that time that would help us identify this coming now? And you know, it's not necessarily a lack of desire to do so. I think it's a lack potentially of, you know, repeatable targets that would tell us which ones are coming.
Yeah, I think it's you know, the benefits of hindsight are amazing. That catalog of diversity for the potential hosts and for potential viruses plus prions and bacteria and other kind of parasites is just really hard to keep a handle on. And I mean, it's one of those funny things of bats have like attracted a huge amount of attention and notoriety now for being the reservoir host for the next viral pandemic and the next viral species of threat. And yet the last coronavirus is the reservoir is for MERS, Middle Eastern Respiratory Syndrome, is camels. So you couldn't get further from a bat if you tried. So it's very difficult to judge what is going to be the next host.
And that's not to say that in places where, you know, pathogens and diseases recur, that you have no hope of being able to detect when the risk and the danger goes up. Plague in the Western United States is a pretty good example. That's the system that Dan and I started working on together, the two of us back in right around 2004 or so. And so plague is in wild rodent populations, ground-dwelling rodents like prairie dogs and things like that here in the West. And it's what I call the Goldilocks of pathogenic bacteria. It lives in the relatively dry parts of the world like this, but in relatively wet years is more prevalent. Right? And so we know to look more so in relatively wet years for plague outbreaks, but we also have sentinels in the sense of when prairie dogs start to die and their fleas become infected, then we know that the risk goes up. And I know Dan has some example of or some experience similarly of plague surveillance in state parks in California, national and state parks in California, right, Dan?
Yeah, but I thought you were going to talk about something else. But predicting it is hard. There's the kind of general rules of that it's perturbance or of natural systems or it's some kind of climate or weather patterns. But often as not, I think it's sometimes they don't turn up. And so you get, it's that uncertainty that is hard to grapple with.
Yeah, and partly I'm trying to contrast that, you know, we have we have the ability to you know, detect a risk of some pathogens. It's not that we're completely without any tools whatsoever, but these are, you know, COVID-19 is novel. It's not one that presumably has been in humans at all before, right? And that's the part that's difficult to predict, right? And to surveil and be completely prepared for, because which one would be next would be, you know, could be quite variable, you know. So it's a how to be ready for the next one, I'm sure, is something we're going to spend a lot of time talking about. But there's really no simple answer to say we could cover the world and discover what's there and protect ourselves without question.
So the case is more or less that it's challenging enough to look for a known pathogen that has known dynamics and recurs at known intervals. But when you're looking for something that you don't even know what it might be like, it becomes all the more challenging, if not impossible.
Pretty close to that, I would say. I mean, you know, it's actually since I was trying to think how, I mean, just, and this is pure off the back of an envelope, you know, not having thought this through very carefully, really, is, you know, how could you have been prepared for, let's say, tests or that sort of thing that would allow you to be ready for this? And, you know, the, you know, you sort of think of this as a recipe. What would a kit look like that would have general ingredients for which then you would be able to add, for instance, and this may be PCR primers that would specifically allow you to identify this one once you got an idea of what it was, and be able to quickly deploy that because the everything in the box except for that last ingredient is ready to go. And that might be, you know, if we know that there are any viruses and we know they're among certain groups and these are the kinds of things that are more likely, we may be able to get to that point of having things that are more easily and more quickly spun up to be able to scale up to the size that we need now. And I suspect that's going to be a big area of research here in the future, in the near future, as we kind of move forward.
No, I think that was brilliantly put, Jim. It's one of the things, it's Louis Pasteur, it's a chance favors the prepared mind. And you see, kind of find the disheartening fact of this outbreak is that this is not a kind of a new occurrence, although the scale of it certainly is. But, you know, we talked through those examples earlier of Zika and chikungunya and swine flu, and these things are not, they are happening, and it requires health infrastructure to deal with it. And it seems to have been this kind of compartmentalization that it's just a thing happening in China. Well, now it's just a thing happening in China and some of Southeast Asian countries, and now it's just those plus Italy, and oh look, it's in Seattle. That kind of, I think the response needs to be changed, that you have to be more proactive earlier and not wait for it to arrive on your own borders before you actually seem to do something this serious and takes it into account. And I know it's a classic trade-off between being prepared and taking action, but then what if that action were not merited? But we're certainly watching the pendulum swing during this occasion.
Yeah, it seems like the astounding downside risk would be some cause for more proactivity, at least in the future.
Yeah, and that's what would that look like in a sense that would make sense? Like, you know, for instance, when there's a network in the United States funded by the National Science Foundation called the National Ecological Observatory Network, which is meant to make atmospheric measurements and ecosystem scale measurements of all kinds of ecological parameters. At one point, it was considered that maybe the sites where those are should also do disease surveillance, right? Essentially just collect rodents and mosquitoes and ticks and things like this, and put samples in freezers and store them for the future to be able to do something with those samples. And I'm pretty sure that part of the reason this ended up changing was that, first of all, you know, the individual players in different places are different. But second of all, it just became this thing of, you know, are we going to fill frozen warehouses full of samples and then maintain them for what cost for how long? Right. And those become, you know, really practical issues in the sense of other pressing needs that arise in the meantime. Right. So the, you know, part of the problem with surveillance is that it's hard to spend resources on it in a time when apparently nothing's happening. Right. And so it's the preparedness side of this, and maybe this will be finally the lesson that tells us that we should just be much more prepared. I mean, we could tick off 10, 12 examples here, probably just in the last 20 years of things that have emerged, probably 30 years for sure. There must be at least a dozen in the last 30 years that have emerged large enough to have, you know, influenced at least some part of the world's population. And so what that preparedness is going to look like in terms of actual physical infrastructure is going to be a very interesting problem to try to solve.
Okay, and I'm curious, in looking back at those past illnesses, you know, obviously there are any number of personal and regional tragedies associated with them, but in terms of, you know, the global pandemic scale, is it more accurate to say that we have been comparatively lucky with them or extraordinarily unlucky with the current pandemic?
Well, pestilence has been, you know, part of the human condition probably as long as we have history recorded about pestilence. And so it's, you know, it is part of the human condition. And so, but perhaps one of the things that may have changed how we perceive it is that we've been fairly successful with public health campaigns and vaccination and things like that, with lowering disease burden dramatically. And so the perceived risk of disease like this has perhaps changed dramatically. I'm not sure that, you know, was 1918 really that long ago? Because that was, you know, influenza, which was a novel strain of influenza to a pretty much, you know, immune-naive world. That, you know, the death toll was probably close to 50 million for that one. And that might be the real parallel to this, of where the world was connected enough that a novel virus, mind you, flu was around before for humans, but this was novel in the sense of who it infected, spread around the world very quickly and caused a very large death toll, right? And so, lucky, unlucky, I think there's a spectrum of these, and we're only going to hit that extreme every once in a while, I guess, is the, you know, as much as I think these occurrences are much more common than we maybe are willing to perceive. And of course, the really big ones, have actually happened more recently than we seem to remember, right?
Yeah, it seems as though there's an element at which, you know, human psychology is poorly matched for this challenge,
or our resilience is matched for the challenge of having had this as part of our history and recovering from it and then moving on, right?
That as well.
Right. And that's that's right. I think it's I try to remind people, for instance, that at my age and my advanced age, you know, I'm old enough to where when smallpox vaccines first showed up and polio vaccines first showed up and measles vaccines first showed up, and the difference in what my school was like in the, you know, essentially starting in the mid-60s in the sense of, you know, how we thought about measles, mumps, rubella, and all these things that would just move their way through, versus now most everyone just doesn't even think about those anymore, right? And, you know, I knew people who were actually affected by polio. There were, you know, kids that were maybe 5 to 10 years older than I was. And, you know, now we, you know, no one remembers what the March of Dimes was, really, right? And that sort of thing. So it's, yeah, we do tend to we do tend to forget these, and I think that's why this one maybe is such a giant shock. I actually don't think a century ago for the 1918 flu is that long ago for it to have faded from memory as much as it had.
Yeah, just to answer both those questions, I mean, I think the luck part comes in that this is rare enough to be a shock. Like Mike was just saying, public health and the advantage of sanitation and comfortable, affluent lifestyles means that these things are the exception and the odd event as opposed to something that we've lived through as a population. If you think going back, you know, like plague and the Black Death and the various other pandemics of plague or smallpox or measles, all these things were major killers that we've managed to just see their influence wane. And I think now, watching these events now, it's a combination of many things, of huge population densities of humans as a susceptible host for something to jump into, and local changes in land use and landscape and climate that are disrupting otherwise natural cycles. And that we are just part of a natural world, and we tend to either forget or willingly ignore that fact.
Yeah. I think that probably the biggest change, though, that allows these emergences, and so for instance, I was talking to a class I'm teaching, which is on evolutionary medicine, and we're comparing we spent a little bit of time before spring break comparing the 1918 flu to this one, to this outbreak, and it's interesting, this, you know, the students themselves turned around and said, yeah, but in 1918, right, how could that, you know, there weren't airplanes yet, so how could that have happened? And I think the, you know, by 1918, there was shipping all around the world, regular enough to where, you know, almost equal, you know, but as a proportion of the population, probably equal numbers of people were moving. They were just moving by trains and ships rather than airplanes. And so the you know, probably the parallel with the 1918 flu is that the world was connected in a way that it really hadn't been before. And that's the one that triggered it. And that's the, if there is one big change, it's that we are connected in a sense. Well, we're connected in a way that is very different than our, of course, our whole human history, right? And it's that connectivity that essentially has left us unlucky for something like this one that's transmissible the way it is to be able to quickly spread, right? And it's a you know, that's probably going to be one of the big lessons as well, is, you know, recognizing that with this connectivity, if something gets going, we have to respond more quickly.
So, and to go back just 20 years from then, actually, and Mike and I both worked on the plague, but I was sending an email to someone and not realizing that I was writing it, that I was like, well, we're talking about a disease agent that's originated in Central Asia, moved to Europe and the States. I was like, well, that's absolutely the pattern of plague around the turn of the 20th century. So these things do just move. Lots of parallels when one starts to think about it.
Yeah.
And speaking of one of those parallels, one thing I was wondering is, I was rereading your 2016 article, which was mostly focused on prairie dogs. You know, are the network effects among, you know, those communities, is it reflected at all or similar in any way to, you know, the same kind of network and spread effects that we see among pathogens within human populations?
I'll let Dan answer that one. He's worked on that.
Yeah, so I mean, I think the parallels are absolutely. So what we looked at with prairie dogs as a model almost for disease spread amongst human populations is that the tiny knit groups, the little family groups of prairie dogs, seem to become affected as a unit. And so one will bring in the infection and they'll all die shortly thereafter. And one of the models that we developed was that if you have some kind of alternate host that does the connecting, and you allow disease to take off, like you get the full-fledged wildfire as opposed to a small smoldering. And I think that's what Mike was just saying, and what you're alluding to is that the connections now that we have between, you know, I don't know how many people had heard about Wuhan 3 months ago, but obviously we're tightly connected, and people are moving all over. And a lot of the what we're watching is kind of, you know, those maps from Johns Hopkins that are brilliant, of looking like a movie. We're watching the spread from country to country or state to state. I think it's already happened, and what all we're doing is trying to play catch up with surveillance data to say, oh, we've confirmed cases. But it's not the first cases that we're seeing. We're just beginning to see these disparate wildfires.
Yeah, that was one of our goals in studying prairie dogs in the first place, was that because of their social biology and gathering into, you know, essentially these colonies, these towns, creates this, you know, the spatial network, and then also the spatial isolation, perhaps, of some towns from others, that, you know, to try to understand how this kind of epidemiology works. And so I think there really is a parallel, and of course that's what we're trying to do now, right? Is we're trying to essentially, you know, become socially isolated or socially distanced or physically distanced at this time, so that, you know, it's not only that we're trying to prevent ourselves from getting infected, but that so those who are infected, you know, pass through that without transmitting. Right, and so it's from both sides. It's the, and you know, there's a parallel to prairie dogs, certainly in terms of our understanding of the spatial biology of how plague outbreaks move their way across the grasslands, have a, you know, really do follow those kinds of patterns and of spatial isolation, and then family groups and connectivity and back and forth, and the modulating of how quickly and how far each of these individual outbreaks occur in different years.
You know, kind of following from those dynamics and the similarities potentially, if you were charged with, you know, potentially studying the types of things that might help prevent this type of outbreak in the future or hasten the response to it, and given it, you know, let's just say an extraordinarily large budget, because this is the sort of situation in which, you know, large amounts of money are spent, what kinds of things would you look at? What sort of questions would you be most interested in answering?
Well, I'll go back. I would test to begin with. Like, for instance, like when we started, I said we have a, you know, 10% positive rate amongst those who are tested, but we're also only testing those that are showing any kind of disease symptoms, right? Of whether it's this or some of the other colds and coughs that are going around, or the flu that's going around. And so we don't actually know, first of all, how many infected individuals there really are. We don't know what the quote-unquote force of infection is, right? How many people of different ages are actually infected and potentially transmitting. The second thing we really need to know is we need to know how many people were, you know, infected and then, you know, perhaps built an immune response and therefore are now, you know, aren't going to be susceptible anymore. Because, you know, part of the idea of this flattening the curve, right, is that we're slowing things down, but there's still going to be a large number of potentially susceptible people in our population still waiting for a second wave of infection. You know, if this thing's really seasonal, for instance, and it stops for the summer, what's going to be the probability of a second outbreak next year? Right? How many are we actually going to have enough immunity in this population to actually get there? So we really need to know pretty much exactly where everybody is in the sense of who's infected and who's not. And the genetic data that are coming in are quite good. I'll just toss it back to Dan. What do you want to?
I guess so. I mean, you can take this with a pinch of salt, because this is almost this is the research element that I love. So I have a natural tendency to want it to be done, and I think it's that looking at that interface between ecology and epidemiology. That we are now in the like absolutely should be this kind of epidemiology study now of like trying to work out how long are incubation periods and when are the latent periods and when do people become infectious. Relevant to symptoms, and what is that going to do in human networks and social distancing, et cetera, et cetera. And I think that's really important. But we alluded to this earlier, that we don't know how this virus jumped from animal X into people. and from what that animal was. And it's if one goes back, the narrative for the SARS outbreak was that it was civet cats that somehow were infected by bats. But it was the civet cats that were acting as this kind of bridge host that allowed people to become infected. But if you look back with this kind of new look now, that we're like, oh, can we learn something from 2002, 2003 that would help us now? And actually, the narrative isn't as strong as we think it is. There are these nice elements that, yes, the SARS coronavirus was related to one that was found in bats, but we don't know any of these mechanisms. And it seems like there's this gap for understanding the ecological component of how did it get from a bat to a civet cat in the first place, if that's even the transmission mechanism that transpired. And again, we're going to be left wondering what happened here for the COVID-19 outbreak. But it would be wonderful to try and kind of hit that interface and try and work out how it's happening. And maybe that would be an element of being able to control and understand and prevent future outbreaks.
Yeah. And mostly we've been answering the question from the epidemiological side of what data we would want to know from that sort of thing. We haven't talked about the biomedical side of this at all, which would be, or additional public health interventions, of course, is what's it going to take to produce a vaccine for this, right? And if we're talking about vaccination or if we're talking about previous infection, one of the things I'd love to know right now, for instance, would be of those individuals who were infected by the SARS virus 17 years ago, do any of them have any immunity to this one? Mm-hmm. And would immunity to this actually spur immunity to the next coronavirus that might come along? That's a very biomedical kind of issue. The other one is, like a lot of viruses, the disease progression and severity of disease varies among individuals hugely. And getting an understanding of how that actually comes about. I mean, certainly the age effects are maybe understandable in the sense of the loss of immune function and other things, but even among individuals, among everyone, and virtually all of these viruses have this feature. Hantavirus has this, and West Nile virus has this, of some individuals who just have massive reactions to these things, perhaps overreactions, and some who have very mild symptoms or no symptoms at all, even with infection. What's the basis of those kinds of issues in the sense of trying to understand how bad the disease would be from one of these, right? And it certainly goes back then to the things that Dan was asking of, how long does it take a person to become infectious, or how long does it take for the onset of symptoms, and how long is this person infectious, and how long are they shedding virus, and when they do shed virus, how long is it lasting on surfaces that they're around, and all those basic questions that we just don't have any answers to right at the moment.
I would just jump in one last thing, because what Mike was saying has generated another thought. And you mentioned that this was an unlimited budget, James.
Yeah.
But I think, so one of the things it seems to be that it's this horrific kind of, I'll say this articulately, but where the markets meet vaccines and public health, and sometimes they don't seem to. So if one looks back at SARS from 2003, the reason it was stamped out was classic epidemiology methods of isolation and slow down the chain of transmission. And that's the same tool that we are trying to adopt now. But one can then look forward a few more years, and we have MERS, the Middle Eastern Respiratory Syndrome, also a coronavirus, also affecting people. But it seems that that's in a disparate population that is, that's a problem for the Middle East as opposed to anybody else. But if you look now, you say, well, we have two coronaviruses that we know are infectious from zoonotic sources, have horrible effects upon people who are infected. So shouldn't we be investing in a vaccine research program to look at how can we combat coronaviruses? And maybe that's going on. And maybe, I like to spend my time chasing prairie dogs. But I don't know. But it seems like that would be one of the things that we should be looking at, of candidates of disease, or virus groups that cause diseases, can we get some kind of momentum into establishing vaccines that might be able to be adopted in the case of the next one?
Yeah.
And, you know, and one looks now and goes, well, of course we should have worked on a coronavirus vaccine, but it seems to lose the focus once the outbreak loses its momentum.
The very last question, if you have just a moment for it, is I was curious what it's like to be in your line of work right now, you know, understanding that we're in, I would imagine, the earlier stages of this pandemic, at least in the United States. You know, how has it been?
For me, I'm not directly involved in any way. I mean, other than our planning that we're doing here at the university for, you know, for how to try to shut things down and keep people safe. But in my classes and things like that, and certainly among colleagues, one of the things I found myself answering a lot is this question of why is everybody getting so excited? This is just like the flu, and why this isn't just like the flu is. You know, just trying to help people understand that the things we need to do to stop this are things we really need to do to stop this, because it's not something we've seen recently, and there's no parallel in our lifetimes for what's actually happening right now at this scale. And so for me, it's mostly been trying to talk to people in my general community who are actually very much questioning whether we should be doing what we're doing.
I don't know how to answer that question. I feel like, yes, I work on zoonoses and I look at diseases that are transmitted from wildlife to human populations, and I study the impacts of epidemiology. And this event, in one way, makes me feel quite useless. That I'm far away, that what I do is too much towards the ecology, animal, end of the spectrum, and what does one have to offer for this, especially when one thinks about friends and family and whatever who actually work in healthcare professions that really are on the front line and dealing with these things, these like really horrific questions of, do you go into work and devote yourself to the public health, or do you worry that you will bring agents of disease back to your home? So I think those questions are really big, and I feel quite irrelevant to them. But at the same time, slowly it's dawning on me that I think with, you know, having worked on this topic for 20 years, that one starts to think of questions that are a little seemingly tangential, but slowly begin to gain importance of traction in my mind of going back to work out, like, what should we really be looking for as a host, and what should we be thinking about in terms of looking at the patterns that keep causing these recurrent epidemics. And so I think it's hard. I mean, I do at least enjoy the fact that I've had 20 years to give some background of not just someone was saying that every Facebook user was an expert in congressional law 4 weeks ago, and now they're all outbreak experts. There is that ability to look at things with a broader perspective, but I think I would like to be able to be doing more.
Yeah, a little bit of the parallel is when there are prairie dog outbreaks here in Colorado and things like, you know, natural areas are shut down and that sort of thing. I've been interviewed several times on the radio, et cetera, to talk about these things. And, you know, without trying to scare the heck out of everybody to say, you know, for plague here in Colorado, oh my goodness, you know, don't go out of your house now. What I try to talk about is, you know, awareness of your circumstances relative to your risk of being infected, right? And which is actually fairly low for plague, really, when it comes down to it. As deadly as that is, it's actually hard to get. But that's to me, you know, what I would turn around and say is I think complacency in the face of emerging disease is not something we can afford to do. You know, if we're going to be savvy members of our society, then I think this is something that we have to be aware that is going to continue, that has occurred and will continue to occur, right? and that we've had the hiatus maybe for, you know, since the antibiotic and vaccination ages knocked a lot of things back, it hasn't eliminated them, and so therefore I would just say awareness. We just need to be, we can't relax on this one. And I think this is what really shows this.
Absolutely. I think that's a good note to leave it on. Thank you both very much for joining me and for your time. And I wish you and yours the best of health.
Yeah, same to you. Best wishes. It's a crazy time. It'll be interesting to see whether we're changed by this when it's over.
Yeah. Thank you, James.
Yep. Thank you, James.
Yep. Thank you.
Bye. Bye-bye.
And that concludes this episode of BioScience Talks. Just a reminder, the journal BioScience is published by Oxford University Press on behalf of the American Institute of Biological Sciences and is made possible by the support of our members and donors. Thank you, and talk to you next time.